physical attacks were done towards this rat model. So you can see there's a lot of strong individual variation, with some birds just feeding their nestlings and ignoring it, while others are actually attacking these rat models. And so it's good that we're able to see that variation. And that's one of my conclusions here, is that these native endemic island species do show some variation. Now, if they didn't show variation, that would be bad. That would mean you just see that flatline response that probably would lead to extinction. Instead, we see some variation. We see some individuals that can respond or are responding to these introduced predators. And that means that over time, maybe whether it's through selection or learning, they'll be able to spread that response throughout the population. Now, in talking about the multi-predator hypothesis, I really only got partial support for that. The Leatherix did respond similarly to both the rat and the snake models, which is what you would expect. However, the Japanese white-eye did not, and they were more variable overall. So I don't have a good reason why, but if you remember, I briefly mentioned that they should retain these behaviors as long as they're not too costly. If the behavior is really costly towards your reproduction, then if that selection pressure that kind of created it isn't there anymore, you'd expect them to lose it. So there could be a difference in the cost of maintaining this behavior between the white eye and the red-billed Leatherix. I don't think that's the case because their responses are really similar towards this predator, and they even sometimes form mixed species flocks when they're harassing these predators. And so I think the costs actually are probably about the same. However, the other idea I've had on maybe why we saw this difference is that in a concurrent nest success study, we saw differences in the nest predation levels. So red-billed Leatherix were undergoing much higher, or at least higher levels of nest predation overall, whereas Japanese white-eye showed pretty low levels of nest predation, around 13% or so. So what could be going on is that these white eyes are just experiencing relaxed selection pressure from all nest predators, and not just a particular one, which should lead to more variation. But they do still have some nest predation. So again, I'm not really sure exactly what these differences are or caused by. So that wraps up the first part of my talk here. And now I'm going to move into part two, which is more about their breeding biology and behaviors living in a restored forest. And I want to compare that to a restoration or to a old growth forest to kind of see how successful they're doing in these restored areas. So as I mentioned in the beginning, the two threats that I kind of pointed out were introduced species to areas, which we've kind of talked about. And then I mentioned landscape change as well. And so humans, wherever we've gone, have also transformed a lot of the environments, whether it's through changing land just to a different use, like pasture land, or sort of whole-scale changing it to urban areas, like this picture of Honolulu here. Now, one way that humans have decided to combat all this landscape change is to actually do restoration. So that just means taking an area that has been converted to some other use and sort of try to restore it back to a state where it can support some native endemic species that we're concerned about. Now, restoration is really costly and labor intensive, right? It takes a lot of time to figure out how to make these native species grow for plants in an area, and then it just takes a lot of money to actually fund that, right? And so we really want to know if it actually works. We want to know that all the efforts we're putting toward restoration are allowing these species to live in these areas. So usually when we kind of evaluate how good we did at restoration, the first thing we want to know is, did this vegetation grow, right? Were we able to get the new structure of this landscape that we were going for? And secondly, we often say, okay, are the animals and other community members actually living or occurring in these areas? And that's usually where our evaluation of restoration stops. But if you remember that reproductive success is one of those key parameters for fitness as a species. So it's really important for us to understand, are they reproducing successfully in an area, not just do they occur there at some points in time. And this is something that with birds, we do by following their nest. So reproductive success in birds mean that they have these nestlings in their nest and they grow up and leave the nest. And this picture here is just showing an example of how we might monitor these nests. So here is a mirror full, so we're just looking at the contents. And in this way, we follow the development of those nestlings right up until they either die or actually fledge and make it into that next stage of their life. So that's kind of what we mean when birds, that's kind of what we use for a proxy of reproductive success. Now, I'll also say that using behavior should also be a part of evaluating restoration, because it is a good way for us to understand what the different costs might be by living in lower or higher habitat qualities. So I'll give an example here that deals with birds, right? Songbirds incubate their eggs. They have to keep them warm. Well, if you're sitting on your nest of eggs, you can't forage and feed yourself. So you have to leave those eggs and take care of yourself. In a lower quality habitat, you might expect that these birds would have to spend more time away from their nest because it may be harder for them to get enough food and resources for themselves, right? In the nestling stage, a similar thing might happen. These eggs are going to hatch, and the birds have to care for their young, so they have to go out and find food. In a lower quality habitat, you may expect that they're going to take a longer time and not be able to feed their nestlings as often as they would in a higher quality habitat. So that's one way that these behaviors can really give us an indication of how the birds are viewing their habitat and whether they consider it high or whether it kind of is high or low quality for them. Now, this doesn't mean that in a low-quality habitat they have zero success, right? They could have a successful nest in the low-quality habitat, but if their behaviors are different than the higher-quality habitat, it would suggest that it's more energetically demanding on those parents for them to actually pull it off and have a successful nest of young. So that leads into my questions here. First of all, are birds breeding successfully in a young, restored forest area? And secondly, what about those breeding behaviors? Are they similar in these restored sites compared to a reference or an old growth area that we're kind of aiming for in our restoration? So I'll explain how this pertains to Hakalau, the refuge where I worked. This image shows Hakalau, and in the foreground you'll see a lot of grass, and this is introduced as well as some dead shrubs that have been sprayed. When Hakalau was purchased, the upper elevations of the refuge were totally converted to pasture land. The lower parts were that rainforest jungle that I showed in the first image. And so this upper part of the refuge was then decided that we needed to restore it, right? And all the green that you see in this picture is actually a restored forest that was started to be planted around 1990 and in the 90s. And now these trees are 20 and 30 feet tall or even more. And so we have since then found that the birds are living in these areas. So we know that they have started to colonize over the past couple decades and begin living in these areas. But we don't know right now is how successful they are at breeding in these restored forests, right, compared to the old growth sites at Hakalau. So this is pictures of these two sites. Right here is the restoration site, and this consists of koa trees. A koa is an acacia species that's endemic to Hawaii. It's really fast-growing. It's a nitrogen fixer. So it's used or utilized a lot in restoration because it can be planted and grown from these pasture grasslands into a nice canopy where other endemic native shrubs can be outplanted underneath. Now on the right side here, you see the reference sites that I'm comparing to in this study. And the reference old growth sites are dominated by this ohia tree here, and also a much denser sort of understory shrub layer. Now these ohia trees aren't used as much in the initial parts of restoration because they're really long-lived, but really slow growing. And so it's harder to get your restoration off the ground by using that tree. Now the birds I'm using are similar to what I used in the first part, but there are a couple differences. And the nice thing about these is they spread across a wide foraging guild range, meaning they're just maybe utilizing slightly different resources to feed on. So with these endemic birds on the left, at the top we've got the apapane, and they are nectarivore, so they do eat other things, but they often just drink from flowers. The next one there is that oiyamakihi, and this is a generalist species. So it eats insects, some nectar, maybe some fruit. At the bottom, this white creeper is actually endangered, and it is an insect specialist. So like its name suggests, it creeps along branches and pulls off insects that way. Now this white yellow pio is actually a flycatcher, so an aerial insectivore, meaning that it darts off of branches to catch insects in that manner. In the introduced birds, we've got the Japanese white eye, which is a generalist, and then the red-billed leothrix down here, which is actually a frugivore predominantly, meaning that it eats fruits. So it should need a little bit more of those resources than some of these other species. Now, monitoring nests in Hawaii, like I mentioned with the predator experiment, is not something you can do by just walking up to the nest and looking inside. Across all species, our average nest height was around 9.5 meters high, and extending all the way up to almost 28 meters high, maybe, for the highest ones. So these pencils are pointing out actual nests way up in the canopy, and so to monitor them, it meant a lot of time staring through spotting scopes at these nests. So we would look through these scopes and judge from the parental behavior what was going on at the nest, whether they were incubating eggs or feeding nestlings. And then once the nestlings got big enough, we could often see little heads poking out, especially when they got fed, so that we could get a better idea of their development and how many there were. Luckily, though, we did have that really big pole, and so instead of putting a predator at the top, we could put a camera at the top. And for nests that were lower than 10 meters, we could reach them in this manner and strap this baby monitor onto a hat, which Tab had shown you earlier in the picture. And then you can actually look at the nest in the camera and see real-time what's in there, whether it's eggs and count them, or see nestlings and how their development is. Now, of course, I also looked at behavior, not just that nest monitoring. And I did this in both incubation and the nestling stages. So we did this by human observations, again, through those spotting scopes from a distance to just observe the parental behavior and care. And I looked at things like their incubation bout lengths, so that's just how long a bird is on the nest versus how long it's away from the nest, and the total amount of time that they spend incubating. Now, during the nestling stage, I wanted to know how frequently they're feeding their nestlings. So this is just how many times they're going to and from the nest with food. Overall, we got, for just these species here, almost 500 nests that we monitored until completion. So until they fledged, meaning the chicks left the nest, or until they actually failed. And you can see the numbers for both the restoration and the reference sites here. So this number of nests equates to literally thousands and thousands of hours of staring at the little spots in the canopy. So I had awesome field crews over the years that would do that alongside me. So the first question is, first of all, are they breeding there and how successful are they compared to these reference sites? So on the y-axis here, we've got the daily nest survival rate. And that's just the proportion of nests that are going to survive from one day to the next. We get these estimates through modeling in a program called MARC. So you can see in red is the restoration sites, in blue is the reference sites nesting for all these species. And the endemic birds are shown here by this green box. The numbers at the top are the sample size, and the error bars are 95% confidence intervals. So what we see here is that there isn't really any difference, and all those confidence intervals overlap for each of these species between both the restoration and the reference sites, which is a good thing. That means that the nesting success is pretty similar between both of these habitats. But what about their breeding behaviors? So during incubation here, we've got time away from the nest. So just the average amount of time that they spend away from the nest before they come back to it. And then here, in this next graph, we've got the proportion of total time that they spend incubating. And again, we don't see very much, or we don't really see any differences between the restoration sites in red and the reference sites in blue. The one species that's an exception here is the Hawaii elapaia. And what's interesting is that they actually spent less time away from the nest and more time incubating their eggs overall than in the restoration site compared to that reference site. So there is that pattern continuing on into the nestling stage, is the next question, and the answer is, whoops, that it is not. So when we looked at the number of trips that they're making to the nest per hour for nestling to feed them, we can see that there's no real difference in their feeding trips. So we did see a difference for the elapio in the incubation behaviors, but in nestlings, it's pretty much the same between the restoration and that reference site. But again, that's a good thing. That means their behaviors are really similar in these restored areas compared to these reference old growth sites. So in conclusion here, I found that these young koa stands are, these restoration sites, are providing pretty viable breeding habitat for a lot of variety of birds that are using maybe different resources to feed on. I didn't find any real differences in nest success or in their nesting behaviors, with the exception of this elapio. And I don't know why its incubation behaviors were different between sites. I speculate that maybe they were able to find food easier for the adults in those restoration sites. Maybe because they're an aerial flycatcher, it's a little more open structure, and so they can find food easier. And if they can, then they could spend more time incubating. But again, that would need a little further study to tease apart what's going on there. Now, the other thing just to note is that this study didn't include the cavity nesting species and others that might heavily utilize some of those shrub layers, because we just don't see them very often in these restored sites yet. They haven't quite colonized those areas up to this point. Now, the other thing I haven't mentioned yet is that koa itself is a very valuable timber species for woodworking and things like making musical instruments, like this ukulele here. I've seen quotes for, I don't exactly remember, something around $50 per board foot or something for koa. And so this means that it could be a real win-win for both conservation and for landowners. It's actually more economically viable for you to convert pasture land in Hawaii now to koa plantations and use this timber to get money instead of cattle, which is great because that would provide habitat for these endemic species. Now, of course, that's provided we don't wholesale cut the forest down in 30 years, but because this is a really valuable timber wood, like you said, for instruments or canoes, it's a viable option to selectively harvest it. So that wraps up the second part here of my talk, and I'll just quickly go back through the results to remind you of them. So in part one, I wanted to know if these endemic birds responded towards introduced predators, and I found that there is some variation in their response. So I found some individuals that really seemed to respond to them, and that's a good thing, because in going forward, selection might be able to persist that response through the population. Now, I also wanted to know if the introduced birds responded to those historical predators. And with that, I found that some species, the leafhoggers there, might be able to maintain their responses, but others didn't seem to. So it's a bit ambiguous. Now, part two, did these birds breed successfully in these restored forests? And the answer is yes, just as successfully as they were in a reference site. Now also, were their breeding behaviors similar in these two forests? And the answer to that again was yes. There was that one exception of the elapio, but if anything, that might be a good thing for those birds. So, it's just some final recommendations here. I think, judging from my results from the first part of this talk, that it's important for conservation for us to understand how these species respond towards introduced predators. And my results kind of suggest that there is variation in these endemic birds, and so if we can help them persist, selection might be able to act upon that variation in some way to help it persist through the whole population. And also, that second part of this talk, I think that we should recognize the importance of evaluating restoration based on how the animal use that area, based on those natural processes. We know that they're living in these areas, but without looking at their reproductive success and breeding behaviors, we would have no idea if it's actually a good place for them to live in terms of their success as a species through time. So, I definitely want to thank all of the field crew members that I've had throughout the years. Again, this took many hours of being in a very wet place, a very cold place, for hours on end just staring up into the trees. But overall, we actually had a great time as a crew, came up with cool hashtags for our tweets. We had some graphic designers in there. We've had some kickboxers in there, so my crew last year was the fittest group of people I've been around. And then we did play a lot of board games in the evenings because our field site was had no internet or anything, and barely any cell reception. So it was us just hanging out in a pretty chilly place playing board games and having a great time. So, of course, I want to thank my field crew, like I already said. And then USGS and the Fish and Wildlife Service were where all the logistics and the funding came from for this project. Also, of course, the Fish and Wildlife Service runs that refuge where all this work was done. And Steve Kindle here is the refuge biologist. And he fights hard to get enough money to have a refuge staff to really put in the efforts it takes to restore the upper part and to maintain that lower part free of some introduced species. So those guys are putting in a lot of time that has made this place a really great spot for the birds and for us to do research in as well. Moving on more to me personally, the Timer Lab group has been amazing from day one when I got here. It's been an awesome lab group. Every week we have super interesting meetings. We give super good feedback to each other. I know my project has been way better just from interacting with other grad students, and especially Ruby and Pete with their Hawaiian knowledge. So I've got some fellow Hawaiian compatriots in the lab group. And then Sean was probably the first person I met outside of Pete, who I met in Hawaii. But Sean was probably the first grad student I met here in the lab when Tad was giving me my tour that first day. And pretty much ever since then, he has been super helpful in everything I've done. We were up until midnight last night, just me and him going over this talk. So it's been awesome to have Sean around. Tom has taught the best class that I've ever taken, and I took it my first semester here in grad school, field ecology, and a lot of you have taken it and may agree with that as well. So I learned probably more from that, like you said, than any other class I've taken since then at NAU, and probably before that in all of my undergrad as well. So definitely thanks for just teaching that class to start with. In relation to my project, Tom has brought a lot of different perspectives to this research, even from analysis to just big ideas that I didn't always think about. I definitely didn't think of doing ordinations, but Tom just spouted that off, and I thought it was a great idea during our committee meetings. So Evan, as Evan mentioned, we've been working together for 4 years now, and I obviously wouldn't be here if it wasn't for Evan, because he hired me on as a field tech back in 2013. That was my first time even getting to Hawaii to start with. So from that year, that was the first year of this nest productivity study, this whole nesting study. And so we kind of were creating it, and Evan really kind of let me take the lead and really start making it sort of my own piece of this demographic project there. And not only that, of course, I was able to incorporate my master's research right into that project. And so that was just a great opportunity for me to just step in and kind of take over running this nest stuff, essentially. And it's been awesome just working with Evan and hopefully continuing to work with Evan on all these projects as well. After every field season, we would meet and chat about how it went. And after the first field season, we met, we thought, oh, it's going good. And I was like, yeah, but if we had more nest searchers, it would be even better. And he definitely agreed. So the second year, we had more nest searchers to help out with the project. The end of that season, we met and talked about it. And I was like, well, if we just had one more nest searcher, it would make this thing go really smoothly. And so Evan was like, OK, I think we can make that work. We can get another nest searcher. So then we had the third year of the project. At the end of that season, I didn't even have to ask. This time, Evan came to me at the end and said, you know, I'm going to get another nester. and so this project went, every year it just got bigger and better and more awesome, and pretty much all that is attributed to Evan and the hard work that he's put. And now he has so many projects going on in Hawaii. Now that I don't know how to keep track of everything that he's trying to do. And then, of course, Tad. Tad has been, I can't imagine, this is my only, obviously my only graduate experience, but I can't imagine what a better advisor would be like than Tad. He came out to Hawaii even before I started on this project, back in 2014. And it was awesome just meeting him before I even had accepted my offer here to NAU, and his helpfulness on just coming up with everything. That first semester, he helped me just keep everything in perspective. That was probably one of the biggest things I learned while in field ecology too. and I think that's been true of everything since then as well that I've learned from him. Every week in lab meetings, he comes up with all kinds of great concepts and ideas for all of our lab groups. Projects and just has really good insights and directions that we should go. And outside of the school stuff, Tad is somebody who always has your back. So if you need anything in life, like, he is there. And so, like I said, I can't imagine what a better mentor or advisor could exist and be like other than Tad himself. So with that, I will take any questions. So these behaviors, at least according to the multi-predator hypothesis, should persist if they have more predation. And these do have other predators. Birds of prey have always been there. And so those underlying behaviors should be there. It's just that response to that particular predator that they need to also have once it gets introduced. And I don't think that they will use any costs on expressing that behavior incorrectly. Because I don't think that happens very often. But I guess I don't know fully the answer to how many times they would incorrectly display those aggressive behaviors.
Yeah, I guess it was also a response to the density of predators. In other words, you can see one individual that's new and they do that, and that after time, if you've got an increasing density of predators in there.
Right. Well, you'd also expect if you have an increasing density of having a decreased amount of reproductive success. Right. As well, even if you're responding correctly every time, some of those predators will get through. So I don't know if you could really tease that apart, at least in terms of their success as a species.
Yeah, I know that's beyond the scope of what you've done, which is really cool. That's a really good study. That's great.
Yeah.
Along the same lines as Randy, do you have any sense of what the distribution of the predators, of the rat predators, are in your study area? Is it evenly dispersed, or are some areas maybe higher predation than others?
Right. So I don't know in all of my study sites specifically. There has been other studies on rats that have sort of seen that there wasn't much difference across in a couple parts of the refuge. I've seen rats, and there are rats in all of the sites where I worked. I don't know those specific densities when I was doing this. That could lead to a difference in the response. For some reason, some parts of it, they don't have them. But all my study sites were within about 5 kilometers of each other in a pretty contiguous forest. So I don't expect there to be any reason why there would be different densities of these guys across the landscape.
So for, I'm thinking about, you know, like in Hawaii and other places similar to Connecticut, like New Zealand, there's a lot of people are taking birds into captivity. And because, you know, well in Hawaii, we don't know why a lot of times the populations are failing, but so for some
taking them into captivity to save them.
Right, to have a captive population. So I'm just wondering, do you think that you have enough evidence to, you know, suggest to managers that maybe before they take, for certain species, like a wild elk pilot, for example, which is a species that's definitely impacted by rats. So, you know, do you think that you have enough evidence to say that it might be worthwhile to do a trial, you know, before you take a pair out for breeding?
Before you release them into the wild?
Is that before you take them in to add them to your captive population, because for having those genes, you know, in your captive population.
Right. Yeah, it probably would be worthwhile to know if the ones that you're going to take into captivity do have maybe the genes in response to some predators. If it is really learned behavior and not doesn't really have a genetic component, then that would suggest that you could really work with the captive birds anyway and train them. So in either case, it'd be worth figuring out for that species, do they have this response? Maybe try to take those into captivity, but also see if you can tease apart how much of it is learned and how much they could be trained in that manner. And I just bring that up because in New Zealand, that's something they've done with their birds, to see if they can train them on these introduced predators, even in the wild. And they have actually had success in terms of training them to recognize a predator using wild birds, even not just birds that they've already brought into captivity.
So kind of on the flip side of that, you know, you have these responses in birds, or on other islands, so predator control is a really important thing that we do. So could you see, like, and it's expensive, and you have to keep doing this predator control constantly because we're going to have these constant introductions probably unless we do incredibly radical economic changes that we're probably not going to be able to do. But could you see a kind of like an argument for not doing predator control if you have this variability in responses and, you know, someday you could have these a population which, you know, naturally does respond to
these? Right. Yeah, 100%. That's something I actually thought of when I started this project, was no one has looked at predator response in the Hawaiian birds, but people are always doing predator control. And even a lot of nest studies have found that, you know, nest predation happens, but it's not necessarily the dominant reason for failure. And so that was something I thought of, was if these birds are responding to predators, then maybe we don't really need to focus on predator control so much, because they're not as naive. And especially if we are seeing it start to take hold in their populations, if we see that variability, it would definitely, I think, be worthwhile to see if that can persist through just like resistance to disease.